Leo the Lion is one of the easiest constellations to find in the night sky. Its shape is one of the few constellations that somewhat resembles the object it represents. Leo is a zodiacal constellation, which means that the sun, moon, and planets pass through this constellation. Leo also contains the sickle asterism, and it's easy to see that crescent shape. I often tell my students I see a backwards question mark. In this video, we will explore the pattern and bright stars of Leo, the celestial objects that are found in this constellation, and some of the mythologies connected to these stars. Welcome to Learn the Sky. My name is Janine, and I'll be your guide as we explore the night sky one constellation at a time. First, we'll get a broad overview of Leo the Lion. It is classified as an ancient constellation, and the earliest records of it date back as far as ancient Mesopotamia. The Persians, Babylonians, Egyptians, Greeks, and Romans all recognized this star pattern. And the name Leo is derived from the Latin word meaning lion, and it is classified as a zodiacal constellation, which means that the sun passes through it. Now, when is the best time to see it? It can be seen in both hemispheres during April, May, and June, and you can see it up to negative 65 degrees in the southern hemisphere. And the way to find it, there's a couple ways. First, I look for the sickle asterism in the sky. To me, I often say it looks like a backwards question mark. And this pattern somewhat resembles what it's supposed to represent. I grew up learning it like this out of the books that I have, so sometimes I struggle to see this pattern, and I see more of like this almost like a sphinx shaped, you know, if this were the head of the sphinx and this were the body. And this constellation is fairly easy to point out. If we go back right here, its stars are all of somewhat even magnitude or brightness, so that makes it easy to find. In the next portion of this video, we'll review over the pattern of Leo the Lion. Leo is a zodiacal constellation, which means that the sun passes through its boundaries. I highlighted this line right here. This line is called the ecliptic, and this is the path of the sun, moon, and stars. And you can see that the ecliptic passes through Leo. Leo is also sandwiched between Virgo, and Cancer would be over here. It's just not pictured in this star map. And remember, a constellation is not just the star that connect the dots, but every star within this black border is considered part of the Leo constellation. But we use the shapes to help us identify where the constellations are. And if we were to zoom in a little bit, you can see this is the backwards question mark or the sickle asterism. The brightest star, the alpha star, is Regulus, and Denebola is the beta star, which represents the tail of the lion. So we'll go in a little bit more detail about those stars in a little bit later. And then here you can see there are some galaxies to see within this constellation as well. Now we'll continue to get more practice identifying Leo's pattern in the night sky. And the key for this is just the repetition. I'm going to try to show you as many photos as possible so you can start to recognize that pattern. So here's the first photo that I showed you. And hopefully at this point, you're starting to recognize the sickle asterism. And then hopefully you can also identify the triangle back end of the lion. This is what the official star pattern looks like. And it is one of those few constellations that somewhat resembles what it's supposed to represent, which is why I like this constellation so much. And it's just so easy to find. It's the first constellation I'm looking for in the springtime. Since I live in the Northern Hemisphere, that's when I can see this. So here you can still see that's where the asterism is. Regulus is right here. And then that's where Denebola is. I learned this pattern like this. And then there is where the asterism is. So now let's get a little bit more realistic picture of what Leo may look like. So this previous photo, this is a longer exposure photograph. So this isn't as realistic. You're not going to see this many stars when you just go out and look outside using only your eyes. But if you have a camera, you can capture those background stars. So this is a little bit more realistic view of what Leo looks like. Can you see the sickle asterism towards the center right? And then can you see the triangle back end towards the left upper side of this photograph? And here I'll just kind of point it out for you. That's where the sickle is. And then here is where the triangle back end is. So let's get a look at a few more pictures. Here is a really good one. I love it because it has the winter sky going into the spring sky, at least for the Northern Hemisphere. And there's a lot going on. So let's orient where we are. So first thing I see is Orion. From there, I can find Canis Major and Canis Minor. I also know Gemini is nearby, and then Taurus is right here. I can see the Pleiades right there. That's how I know it's Taurus, as well as the Hyades with the V-shaped face and the horns of the bull. And then moving forward, let's go back to Gemini. Then we have Cancer right here. Now, Cancer's pattern is a little difficult to see, but I'm looking at this star cluster, and that's called the Beehive star cluster. I have videos on like almost all these constellations I'm talking about, so be sure to go see those videos if you want to learn more. And then finally, we have Cancer here, and Leo is right there. And that's kind of the order. You have Gemini, Cancer, Leo, and then Virgo would be over here if we were to extend this photo out. Also, you can see Ursa Major right here. This is part of the Big Dipper. And that's what you can use to aim yourself towards Leo the Lion. And here's just kind of a sneak peek of, I didn't trace out the patterns, but I at least circled where a majority of these constellations are. And you can use Ursa Major to help you find Leo. So here's a great diagram I use all the time. If you can find the Big Dipper, you can use these two stars within the Big Dipper and aim you towards Leo the Lion. The Big Dipper is so important because it just points to all different areas in the sky for us. Another thing about Leo is that it's part of the spring triangle, which I highlighted here, right there, or perhaps the spring triangle is this. I find there's multiple reports on which parts are the spring triangle. But anyway, you can use, again, Ursa Major to aim you towards Leo. You can also use Ursa Major to arc to Arcturus, and then speed to Spica, and you'll get to Virgo. So that's kind of another way you can use to help you find Leo. If you arc to Arcturus, speed to Spica, you know that Leo must be nearby. In the next portion of this video, we'll take a look at the bright stars that are within the constellation of Leo. So here again, we have this original photo I showed you of Leo the Lion. Hopefully you're recognizing the pattern that I'm tracing out at this point. The brightest star, known as the Alpha Star, is called Regulus, and that name is Latin for Little King, and it's estimated to be 77 light years away. This is a really interesting star system because it's not just one star that you're looking at, but it happens to be a four-star system. So it's organized into two pairs. So you have the main star right here. This is Regulus A, and this is a blue-white main sequence star, and its companion is right here. And then you have Regulus B right there. That's another dim main sequence star. And then Regulus C is here. So these two are one pair, and then these two are the other pair. So it's really interesting that when you're looking at this bright star system in Leo the Lion, it's actually four stars. And then the next bright star that's easy to find is called Denebola, and this is Latin for lion's tail, and it's estimated to be 36 light years away. So it's much closer. Okay, this one is closer than this star, but this one is brighter, and this is the second brightest. And Denebola is classified as the beta star, which means it's the second brightest in the whole star pattern. And it's classified as an A-type blue main sequence star, and it has 75% more mass than the sun, and it's 12 times more luminous. It is a variable star, so its brightness its brightness can vary over the course of a few hours. Now we'll review over the celestial objects that are seated within the constellation of Leo. So I have some of these highlighted. There are quite a few galaxies that are within this constellation. And in fact, most of what's in this constellation are galaxies. And that's what it's like in the springtime. We can see distant galaxies because the Earth is oriented away from our own Milky Way galaxy, so we're able to see these. But the ones I'm going to focus in on are the Leo triplet, located right here within the star pattern. And then we have Messier 95, and then Messier 105. And remember, this is just a different star map. All these little red ovals right here, that are just dotted throughout this constellation, these are all galaxies. So that is primarily what you will see. You definitely need magnification to see them, but at least you know that they are there. So let's get started with the Leo triplet. So here is what the Leo triplet looks like through a telescope. And if we were to label these, this one here is NGC 3628. And then we have Messier 65 and 66. Really close to each other. And if we were to zoom in here using kind of what I like to call like a NASA-sized telescope, one that's able to zoom in and get some definition on these objects, this is what it looks like. And it's just really incredible to see. Messier 65 is a spiral galaxy estimated to be 35 million light years away. And then Messier 66, this is a barred spiral galaxy, also estimated to be 36 million light years away. And then NGC 3628 is classified as an unbarred spiral galaxy estimated to be 35 million light years away. So that's located right here, and it's kind of near the triangle back end of Leo. So again, you would need magnification to see it, but now you know it's there. So next we'll move into Messier 95. It's here labeled as 96, but that's because 95 and 96 are like right on top of each other. So that's why that label kind of blends in. So Messier 95 is a barred spiral galaxy estimated to be 35 million light years away. This is just such a gorgeous picture of that galaxy. And here is another version of what it looks like. This is just the entire galaxy, but I love when we're able to zoom in. There's just more definition here. And you can see like bluer stars are located in the disk of the galaxy. That's where lots of star formation happens. And then Messier 66, also called NGC 3368, is a barred spiral galaxy, also estimated to be 35 million light years away. And you can see there's other galaxies within here too. So this is just such a great photograph to look at. And then we also have Messier 105. So if we were to back up here, we got a better photo. There we go. So in between, I guess, Denebola and Regulus, like right in the middle is where Messier 105 would be. And this is an elliptical galaxy. So it's kind of like football shaped. It's moving out equally, from its center, at least all the stars are, and typically these are older galaxies in age, and it's estimated to be 35 million light years away. So those are the main celestial objects that you can see. Remember, you do need magnification, so I wish you luck trying to find all of these cool galaxies within Leo. In the final portion of this video, we'll review over some of the mythologies and legends that surround Leo. It is often the stories of the stars that we can connect to in some way, which can help us remember the constellation. And remember, there are lots of tales about the constellation, so there's no one true and correct mythology. But our most ancient evidence of Leo comes from the Babylonian star catalogs. And this was a catalog of 71 stars and constellations that were the predecessors of the zodiacal constellations. And many of the constellations of the zodiac that we know today were recorded in the Babylonian star catalogs, even represented some of the same things they do now. And this star catalog also had a path of the moon and planets, a solar calendar, lots of information. And here, this is the name that was associated with Leo at the time. I'm not even going to try to pronounce this, or I wouldn't even know where to start, but this is our first recognition of Leo in our history that is recorded. The Egyptians also recognize Leo the lion, and there's multiple legends that I've read about. The one that stood out to me is that one legend states that lions came to the Nile River during the summer months to cool off, and the summer is when the sun, our star, passes through Leo. So that is a possibility. I'm sure there are more legends out there, but many people are familiar with the tales from Greek mythology about Heracles. And Heracles had to battle what was known as the Nemean lion. This was a mythological creature that fell from the sky, and then became a lion and was ravaging the countryside, and Heracles had to slay the beast using his hands because he was impervious to all their types of weapons. But this is one that maybe you might think of Hercules, but Hercules is the Roman version of Heracles. Remember, Greek mythology came first and then the Romans followed. But keep in mind that there are lots of mythologies out there. They vary according to time, place, and culture. So there's no one true mythology for any constellation, just a variety of them. We've come to the end of our video about Leo the Lion, so let's review everything we've learned so far. It's best seen in the spring months in the Northern Hemisphere, and it's virtually visible from everywhere in the world, except maybe Antarctica. It's classified as a zodiacal constellation, and the best way to find it is to use Ursa Major, use the pointer stars to aim you towards Leo. You should also look for the sickle asterism. That is a great way to help you find the shape of this star pattern in the sky, and the celestial objects that you'll find within the boundaries of this constellation are all galaxies. The Leo triplet, located in this region right here of the constellation, is definitely one to look for, but you will need magnification. So thank you so much for watching this updated video about Leo the Lion. I'd also like to thank David Coughlin for allowing me to use some of his pictures of the beautiful Leo triplet. This is something I have seen before. It's really fascinating, so I hope you get a chance to see it as well. I would say that Leo the Lion is one of the easiest constellations to find, so I hope this video was helpful for you in order to find strategies on how to find it, what it looks like, what's inside of it, and some of the legends behind it. Thank you, as always, for watching. Remember, keep going outside, take a friend with you, and as always, keep looking up.